Hi, good evening everybody. Welcome to Unacademy. Let's crack NEET PG. And let me introduce myself. I'm Dr. Deepika Gupta. I've done my MBBS and MD in Obstetrics and Gynecology from AIIMS New Delhi. And I've done MCH in Surgical Oncology and I'm working at Sir Gangaram Institute. This is my Telegram channel, so you can drop in any queries that you have, any topics that you want me to discuss particularly with you. Okay. And I'll also be putting out whatever classes I'll be taking for the week on this. So Unacademy brings to you two subscriptions. The first is the Plus subscription. So Plus subscription has a lot of daily live classes, live tests and quizzes, and it covers your entire course in a structured manner. Once you take this subscription, you get unlimited access to all these sessions, right? The second is the Iconic subscription, where you have the access to live classroom of Unacademy as well as to the content from PrepLadder. So PrepLadder has a lot of pre-recorded video lectures on all your important topics and question banks, and also a lot of rapid revision courses. So, Unacademy brings to you a lot of offers for you, and since we know that the exam is a little delayed and we don't know the exact date yet for the NEET PG, however, the INICT is fast approaching. So, for those of you who are in the second year, third year, these subscriptions are very, very ideal for you, and we have a lot of discount going on them. So you can see that there has been such a serious drop in the prices for this, and you can obtain the Iconic subscription, where you will get access to both the live classroom of Unacademy as well as the content from PrepLadder. So other than that, we have a scholarship test that is scheduled for 10th of July. So here the topic is slides in pathology, and the winner of which, their first rank, is going to give 100% scholarship for Plus subscription. So according to your rank, up to 20 ranks, you can get 75% scholarship, 50% and 25% scholarship. Okay. Now, so another offer that we have going on is, if you take a subscription for 3 months, you get a subscription for 1 month free. And for those of you who take a subscription for 12 months, you get a subscription of 2 months free. Right. So for those of you who are in your first year, we also have a 4-year subscription. So you can see that if you take a 4-year subscription, then it is going to help in building your concepts, because you know, more and more exams are asking questions that are clinical based, and they integrate two or more subjects. Like, they will integrate your microbiology or pathology with pharmacology, and then later on with medicine, right? So that's why these kind of courses are going to be very useful for you. Right. And we have a new feature, that is raise a hand. So you can now use this feature to ask a doubt in between the classroom itself. So it is going to imitate your live classroom to the extent that is possible. Okay. Now we have a new batch which has just started on 30th June. Okay. So here there is going to be high topic wise clinical MCQ based marathon. So for this is only for your clinical subjects, where there is going to be all MCQs and very quick discussion of those MCQs, so that you can revise all your high yield topics, okay, and also know how to use that information. We also have another batch which has started on 30th June, which are dual educator sessions, okay. Now, so we have another batch that is for your NEET PG 2021. So this is meant for revision for this exam that is coming up. There are also going to be two grand tests which can help you create an environment for the exam, right? And the focus is on integrated clinical long form questions. So on the newer type of questions that are anticipated. Right. Then we also have another batch that is started on 30th. Now, for those of you who are targeting the exam that is going to happen next year, so we have a batch that is starting in June, which will go up to January. So almost 6-7 months. Right. Now, these batches are going to be detailed discussions, concept buildings. Here you can ask your doubts, do MCQs, read a topic. OK. And you will also be provided with the recorded sessions of these. Then we have a Focus FMG batch that has started on 30th June. Right. Now, this is also going to be a detailed discussion, concept building, doubt clearing. doing, right? Now, coming to the cost of it. So for those of you who are in your first year, second year, if you choose to take the Plus subscription or the Iconic subscription now itself, then you will realize that it is much more economical for you and much more academically useful for you, right guys? So if you have the, if you want to take the Plus subscription, use my code Dr. Deepika and you're going to get a 10% discount. Similarly, if you are going to use, if you want to buy the Iconic subscription, and you can see that if you take a longer duration, it's more economical for you, right? And use my code Dr. Deepika on it to get another 10% discount, right? So today we are coming to the topic at hand. We are going to be talking about antenatal screening or prenatal screening. Okay, so first we will talk about what are the basics of screening, what is a screening test, what are the tests that I use, then what is the first trimester screening and what is the second trimester screening. Right. So screening is basically a test that is applied to a apparently healthy population. Right. Now, when we will talk about prenatal screening, we are applying tests to a apparently healthy pregnant lady. Right. So screening basically aims to identify unrecognized disease or defect by means of tests which in apparently healthy individuals. Okay, this is going to help us to identify what is the risk estimate of an individual. This is not a diagnostic test. A screening is basically, suppose if you have 100 people and you apply a screening test to them and you find that the screening test has come positive in some 10 people, let's say. Okay, this is a very high prevalence in some 10 people. Then what do? After this, we are going to apply a diagnostic test to them. Okay, a diagnostic or a confirmatory test. Okay, just because the screening test has come positive, I am not going to go to treatment or I am not decision. Okay, I will apply a diagnostic or a confirmatory test. Out of this, whoever comes out to be confirmed positive, then I am going to take my therapeutic measures. Okay, so that is the difference between a diagnostic and a screening test, and we must all remember this. For example, you have your pap smear, right? So pap smear, if you remember, I told you many times that pap smear is a screening test. If on pap smear I get HCl or I get CIN3, I don't start treatment. I am going to do a colposcopy and biopsy. Similarly, the same case will be applied in prenatal screening also. Okay, now for such kind of test that has to be done in apparently healthy individuals, it should be very easy to perform test, okay? And it should be accurate, variation should be very less, should be acceptable to the patient and reproducible among different individuals, okay? So this is also a little bit of PSM, but we must understand what is a screening test. Now, why do we do antenatal screening? So, you know, previously you must have seen or maybe somewhere in your locality or in your families, you must have seen somebody had a kid with Down syndrome. Somebody had a kid with some very gross congenital malformation and that kid died. Or somebody has a kid with Down syndrome who's now grown up, maybe 10 years, 12 years, 15 years, right? But now that to decrease this prevalence, we have antenatal screening. So basically, what is antenatal screening going to do? You have a lot of pregnant ladies. In that, it is going to identify what is the high risk group. Okay, just on the basis of the screening, I am not going to do a definitive therapy. I am not going to do a medical termination of pregnancy and all. But it is going to tell me that out of all these ladies are high risk. This is aimed to reduce the incidence of any major structural single gene disorders and chromosomal disorders. Okay, and it also helps to decrease the parental anxiety and it helps to plan the pregnancy, right? So what are we screening for? See, antenatal screening we are mainly doing for aneuploidies. So you know, aneuploidy is your trisomy, is your monosomy, right? So we are mainly doing it for aneuploidies. So trisomy, the three famous ones that we must always remember, 21, 18 and 13. So 21, all of us know it is Down syndrome. 18 is Edward, okay? And 13 is Patau syndrome, okay? Other than this, very famous, another is monosomy X or Turner syndrome, okay? Turner syndrome. So these are the ones we are mainly concerned about. Now, these aneuploidies may be associated with spontaneous abortions, they may be associated with stillbirths, or they may be associated with gross congenital malformations. Okay, so got it? So all aneuploidies will not present with gross congenital malformation. A lot of these are going to be aborted in the first trimester itself. And you must remember, your monosomy X or Turner, almost 80 to 85% are aborted in the first trimester itself. Okay, your trisomy 18, almost 80 to 85% are aborted. But what about trisomy 21? Down syndrome, the abortion rate is not that high. It is around 25 to 30%. You don't need to remember this number, but you need to know that Turner abortion rate is much higher. But Down syndrome abortion rate is not as high. So that is why live Down's baby are more, and that is why all the antenatal screening work is focused on Down syndrome. Right? Now, all these aneuploidies can also lead to stillbirths, or they can lead to gross congenital malformations. And now with the advent of ultrasound and with the rampant and correct use of level 2 ultrasound, or also called as the anomaly scan, we are able to pick up a lot of GCA. Now, when we pick up this gross congenital malformations, what is the benefit of it? We are thinking now, yes, that there can be an aneuploidy, and I should do something. I should do a test to confirm that aneuploidy. If it comes positive, I need to terminate that pregnancy. Got it? Now, with now more and more better ultrasounds are coming up. So not all anomalies are picked up on level 2 ultrasound. There are a few anomalies, particularly your open neural tube defects, like your anencephaly and all. They can be picked up early also. That is called as your early level 2 scan, can be called, or it is basically when you are doing your dating scan when you're doing your nuchal translucency, okay, that is done at 11 to 14 weeks. At that time also you can pick up some malformations, okay, pick up some gross malformations. Got it? So this is the basic concept of antenatal screening. Right? So this is, I told you about aneuploidies, but I also told you we also want to pick up single gene disorders. So single gene disorders can be in the form of metabolic disorders, okay, like your Gaucher's disease and Tay-Sachs and all that. Then it could be hematological disorders, okay, such as your thalassemia or hemophilias. So suppose, or then you could have your congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Suppose the couple has a kid, okay, and the previous kid is suffering from a metabolic disease or a hematological disease, hemophilia or congenital adrenal hyperplasia, then all this will come into play. Okay, now, so there are certain risk factors for more and more malformations. So the basic background risk of developing a GCA, a background risk of a congenital malformation, is somewhere around 2 to 3%. Okay, not more than that. But there are some certain factors which are going to increase the risk factors. So first, most important is maternal age. Maternal age more than 35 years is associated with non-disjunction of the chromosomes during meiosis. And that's why we land up with so many trisomies. Then it could be multiple pregnancy. Suppose there is a previous history of aneuploidy. A couple has a kid with Down syndrome. Then the risk increases to 1%. If the parents are carriers of chromosomal translocation. Okay, sometimes in recurrent pregnancy loss could be due to some chromosomal anomaly, and if the ultrasound is suggestive of a gross congenital malformation, then we should definitely think about aneuploidies. Right, now so let us see what is first trimester screening, what are the tests we are using, then what are the tests we are using in second trimester screening. So in first trimester screening, you have two types. The first is biochemical, right? Biochemical screening, and the second is your ultrasound. So in biochemical screening, you have your beta HCG and PAPA, right? Beta HCG, we are all familiar with. What is PAPA? Pregnancy associated plasma protein A. Okay, now this is your biochemical screening. Then the second, when is this biochemical screening done? This is generally done at the time of your between 10 to 14 weeks. ओके. जनरली वी प्रिफर 11 टू 13 प्लस 6, यू शुड रिमेंबर लाइक दैट. 11 टू 13 प्लस 6 वीक प्लस 6 वीक्स इज द आइडियल टाइम फॉर योर फर्स्ट ट्राइमेस्टर स्क्रीनिंग, राइट. नाउ सेकंड इज अल्ट्रासाउंड. सो इन अल्ट्रासाउंड व्हाट डू वी लुक एट? वी लुक एट न्यूकल ट्रांसलुसेंसी, वी लुक एट नेजल बोन. दीज आर द टू मेजर मार्कर्स. सपोज इफ समटाइम्स दे माइट गिव यू इन ऑप्शंस दैट देर आर सम अदर मार्कर्स दैट वी लुक फॉर, राइट. व्हाट आर दोज मार्कर्स? यू हैव ट्राइकस्पिड रीगर्जिटेशन. Okay, and abnormal ductus venosus flow. Okay, we don't need to know the details about these two, but we need to know because they are given in some of the options. So these are the other markers, but we will be reading about these in detail, right? So first is free beta HCG. So beta HCG, we know it is produced by the syncytial trophoblast, and you have a total HCG and you have the free beta HCG. So here we are measuring the free beta HCG, and this is it is a small percentage of the total HCG. So you know that beta HCG is produced by your syncytial trophoblast. It will start increasing, the production starts increasing and peaks somewhere around 10 weeks. After that, your placenta is going to take over. Now, the important thing that now here we need to remember is that this free beta HCG is elevated in Down syndrome. So, free beta HCG is increased in Down syndrome, right? Now, whereas in your other trisomy, whether it is trisomy 18 or it is 13, it is reduced. Okay, because they like to ask you these questions. Now, the second is your placenta pregnancy associated plasma protein A. Okay, so this has is also produced by your syncytial trophoblast. It has a row, just a second. Yeah, so it has a role in trophoblast invasion and placentation. This PAP A goes on increasing as the gestation increases. So this is the normal curve for PAP A. Okay, whereas your free beta HCG, I told you that the peak is going to be somewhere around 10 weeks. After that, your beta HCG falls. This is a normal pregnancy. Okay, this is a normal pregnancy. So if you remember this graph, you can remember in a normal pregnancy, the free beta HCG is peaking at 10 weeks. After that, it's going to fall, right? Whereas your PAP A, what is going to happen? It increases with gestation. Okay, so in a normal pregnancy, it increases with gestation. Okay, but in Down syndrome, what is going to happen? It is going to decrease in trisomy 21. In your trisomy 18 and 13, both are decreased. PAP A is also decreased and beta HCG is also decreased. Now, increased levels of PAP A are seen in preeclampsia and preterm birth. Okay, so I'm just trying to integrate, or because these markers you will be reading in your preeclampsia also, you have read about in small for gestational age fetus also, because PAP A has been found to correlate with that. Okay, now the next comes nuchal translucency. Now, what is nuchal translucency? Nuchal translucency, you must remember this image, you have, see, this is the fetal head, this is the fetal thorax, okay, this is an, and here you can see, this is the fetal skin, okay, this is the fetal skin, and this hypoechoic or dark region between the skin and the soft tissue behind the cervical spine is called as nuchal translucency. So if they give you this image and they ask you what are we looking at, then we are looking at nuchal translucency. Okay, now when do we measure this nuchal translucency? We will typically measure, see, this is the way fetus should be in that. Okay, now we are going to measure it at what gestation? I told you between 10 to 14 weeks. And there is also a criteria of CRL given for it. Okay, the crown rump length. It should be between 36 to 84 millimeters. 36 to 84 millimeters. MCQ can be asked on this. Okay, and how do we measure it? It is measured in the mid sagittal plane, right? You can see this kind of cuts are taken, and the neck should be in the neutral position, and we will measure this hypoechoic space between the skin and the soft tissue behind the cervical spine. Okay, so this much and this figure about the NT we should be knowing. Now, raised NT. So what is the cutoff of NT we take? Generally, we take a cutoff of 3 millimeters. So a NT or nuchal translucency at 11, your 10 to 14 weeks up to 3 millimeter is okay, but more than 3 millimeters is a danger sign, right? So what is a danger sign? What is it telling us? It is telling us that it could be that their fetus is having some chromosomal abnormality. Okay, so it is associated with aneuploidies, your trisomy 21, Turner syndrome. Okay, now, and other than chromosomal abnormalities and aneuploidies, there can be another problem, and that is congenital heart defects. Right, so raised NT is associated with these problems. Chromosomal abnormalities, first thing I should think. I should think about congenital heart defects. I should think about skeletal dysplasia. Right, now in the chromosomal abnormalities, either it is trisomy 21 or it could be Turner syndrome. Right, now what about in trisomy 21, generally there is some subcutaneous fluid collection. In Turner syndrome, what happens, there are huge collections and they are basically cystic hygromas present. Okay, there is presence of cystic hygroma. Okay, now, so when you have a fetus, you have done a scan and you did at 12 weeks, okay, and you saw that the NT was greater than 3 millimeter. So I am going to do two things. I am going to think about doing a karyotype, right? So, and I am going to do, so for karyotype, I need some sample from the fetus, right? And what sample can I take? So if I'm doing it between your, at 12 weeks, what sample can I take? I can take a chorionic villus sample. Okay, the second thing I need to think about is structural anomalies, particularly congenital heart defects. Okay, so yes, I am going to go for a scan at that time and I'm going to try and look for any congenital malformations, but it might be difficult to identify all malformations at this current gestation, and maybe we have to call the patient again after a few weeks for a detailed ultrasound and echo. Got it? So a raised NT should raise in our mind two things. One is your karyotype or chromosomal abnormality, and for that we will do invasive testing. And the second is structural anomaly, particularly congenital heart defects. Right? So now another thing that we look on these scans is nasal bone. Okay, nasal bone. So here you can see this calcified thing is your nasal bone, and above this one skin, the skin layer is going to be there. So this is called as a equal sign. Okay, equal sign is seen. So that is the normal nasal bone, but nasal bone hypoplasia may be there. So right here, you in this figure, you can see that there is no nasal bone or absent nasal bone. So absent nasal bone or hypoplasia may be associated with trisomies, or it could be associated with warfarin use. Right? Got it? Okay. Now, so we have talked about two types of testing. We talked about your biochemical testing, in which we have your beta HCG and PAPE, and we talked about ultrasound, in which we were looking at NT, nuchal translucency, in detail, and another marker I told you is nasal bone. Right? Now, what is combined testing? So when the lady is coming to you at 11 to 13 weeks, 6 days, what are we going to do? We are going to do a combined testing, and this testing has to be done for all irrespective of age. Right? Irrespective of age. Yes, I told you that more than 35 years, the risk of developing or these aneuploidies, chromosomal your malformations increases. But it is not like all Down syndrome will be born in a woman who is 36 or 37 year old. It can happen in younger women as well. Right? So that is why we are going to do a testing in all women. We are going to take into consideration the age. We are going to take into consideration serum markers. That is your beta HCG and PAP-A. Right? And we are going to take into consideration your nuchal translucency. So together we are going to come out with a result. Okay? This is your combined testing, and the accuracy of this combined testing is somewhere around 92%. Okay, if this comes as high risk, then we need to go for invasive testing. If it comes to be low risk, then we don't need to go for any other further testing. Okay, got it? So this is your combined testing. So that is why you must remember, a lot of you must have heard about triple screen. Right, triple screen was very, very famous previously, because that was the only test we had standardized at that time. But it is done in the second trimester. It is done around 16 to 18 weeks. But now we have a test which can be done earlier at 11 to 13 weeks, 6 days, or 11 to 14 weeks. So why should we not take advantage when the accuracy is so good and it is going to give the parents a diagnosis much earlier in the pregnancy? If a medical term, if a termination of pregnancy is required, it can be done with much more ease. Right, so that is the entire concept of combined testing and how we have moved from second trimester screening to first trimester screening. Right, now let us go to second trimester screening. What do we do in second trimester screening? So I told you in the first trimester we had done beta HCG and we had done PAPE. Okay, now we are going to do in triple screen, that is done at 16 to 18 weeks generally, we do a unconjugated estriol. Okay, so we have to be very, very careful with what are the full forms of all these, because they will give you different options and they will write full forms and you might get confused. Okay, then we do a beta HCG and we do a maternal serum alpha fetoprotein. So this is your triple screen. Then came the concept of doing a quadruple test. So quadruple test, as you understand, four markers, all these three markers plus your inhibin A or dimeric inhibin A. And this quadruple test can be done from any time between 15 to 21 weeks, right? The accuracy of the quadruple test is much better, and in the Western countries, in US and all, quadruple test is the test that is still done. But yes, we have our own constraints, we have our resource problems. So wherever it is available, we are trying to do. Otherwise, we mostly rely on triple screen. Right, another screening modality for your second trimester is your genetic sonogram or a detailed anomaly scan or a targeted ultrasound scan. Right, so we have triple screen, we have quadruple screen, and we have a genetic sonogram. Okay, so first thing is unconjugated estriol, right? It is a steroid molecule, it is produced from the fetal adrenal gland and the placenta. Okay, and the precursor is your DHEA. It increases with the gestational age. Okay, it increases with the gestational age in a normal pregnancy. Just like I told you about PAPE, same way unconjugated estriol also increases. Right. Second comes your alpha fetoprotein. So alpha fetoprotein, previously a lot of questions have been asked about alpha fetoprotein, because your maternal serum alpha fetoprotein was not only used for diagnosis of chromosomal anomalies, it was also used for your neural tube defects and your abdominal wall defects. Okay, now that use has been replaced a lot by ultrasound, but still they can ask you one of the older questions. So alpha fetoprotein production, from where is it produced? All these are MCQs. Early pregnancy, it is produced from the fetal yolk sac. Later on, it is produced by the GI tract and liver. Okay, now your what is going to happen? The AFP is produced by the fetal yolk sac or the GI tract and the liver in the fetal serum. So the level in the fetal serum is going to keep on rising. When the fetus is going to pass urine, then this AFP is going to go into the urine also. Right, so you have to understand your fetal serum AFP, amniotic fluid AFP, and then finally maternal serum AFP. Okay, so when the fetus will start passing urine, it is going to go into the amniotic fluid, and this fetal serum AFP is the highest value one. Okay, this is also an old MCQ, highest value it will attain. And it is peaks somewhere around 13 weeks. Okay. Your amniotic fluid AFP also peaks around 13 weeks. Now, after 13 weeks, what happens? This AFP will start leaking into the maternal circulation. Okay. And slowly, slowly, the maternal serum AFP will start rising after 13 weeks. Got it? After 13 weeks. And it will peak somewhere around 28 to 32. Right, so these are all old questions that have been asked on alpha fetoprotein. Right, so increases in both the fetal serum and the amniotic fluid until 13 weeks, after which it will rapidly decrease. It increases in the maternal serum after 12 weeks and peaks at 28 to 32. Okay, now an important thing we need to remember: AFP is high in neural tube defects, particularly your open neural tube defects and your abdominal wall defects like your omphalocele and gastrocheisis. Okay, so in Fallacyl, what happens? There is an enlarged umbilical ring, and your gut contents are going to protrude through that enlarged umbilical ring, and they are all covered by this amnion or the peritoneal lining. Right? What is your gastroschisis? Gastroschisis is when there is a para-umbilical defect in the abdominal wall through which the contents are protruding. Now here there is going to be no covering. Right? So you must remember, with alpha fetoprotein, two things: neural tube defects and abdominal wall defects, where your alpha fetoprotein level is going to increase. Right? The level is decreased in trisomy 21. Right? So you have to remember what happens to all these markers in your Down syndrome. Now, so but there are many other reasons of elevated levels of AFP and low levels of AFP. So when can we have an elevated level? Suppose we have underestimated the gestational age, because we know that it is rising with the from 13 weeks onwards, it is rising in the maternal serum. It could be multiple pregnancy, it could be fetal death, neural tube defects, gastroschisis, omphalocele, cystic hygroma. All these are associated with elevated levels. There is a very long list. I have just kept a few important ones. Right? Then the second is low level. Low level can be seen in trisomy 21 or 18. It could be in GTN, right? Because there are no fetal parts only. There is no fetal liver, no GI tract. Then you have your fetal death, overestimated gestational age, or low levels are also seen in obesity and diabetes. Okay, so we have to try and remember this list. Now next comes your inhibin A. So inhibin A has been added in the quadruple test, which is done around 15 to 20 weeks. It is produced by the gonads and the placenta. And this inhibin A is elevated in trisomy 21. Okay, so till now, what did I tell you? In trisomy 21, beta-HCG is elevated, PAP A is low. Okay. Then when we go to the triple screen, you have your unconjugated estriol, you have your maternal serum alpha fetoprotein, and you have your beta-HCG, right? So beta-HCG is elevated, both estriol and AFP have fallen. Then you go to the quadruple screen and you add inhibin A. Now you see that the inhibin A is increased in trisomy 21. So you must remember what happens to each of these markers in trisomy 21. Okay? Now, so this I have just kept a table for your revision. So this one we have just discussed. Alpha fetoprotein is produced in the fetal liver, unconjugated estriol, fetus and placenta, inhibin A by ovary, beta HCG and PAP A by the placenta. Okay, when are we measuring? We already know which watches the first. These two are your first trimester markers. Okay, then beta HCG is also measured in the second trimester, and these are your second trimester markers. Now in trisomy 21, only two of them are increased, that is inhibin A and beta HCG. All these AFP, estriol and PAP A are reduced. Okay, got it? Now in your trisomy 18, we do not measure inhibin A, if we can remember this. Remaining all the markers are reduced. Now this percentage we don't need to remember, it's just that all these are reduced. In trisomy 13, you have to remember that inhibin A is increased. Okay, if nothing at all, trisomy 21, we need to remember what is happening to each of these markers. Okay, now then other than that, yes, there are a lot of other factors that also have a role to play. I just explained to you diabetes mellitus, your AFP levels are going to be less, smoking, multiple pregnancy, maternal weight, all these are going to also associate affect your levels of these markers. So you have generally adjustment factors will be there, after which the geneticist will address and give you the risk according to the history of diabetes, smoking, multiple pregnancy, maternal weight. Okay, now we have a new test or a new modality available with us, that is non-invasive prenatal testing. What is a non-invasive prenatal testing? See, you know that there is a fetus which has its own cells, and we are going and sampling these fetal cells by your amniocentesis, chorionic villus sampling and all. Now, we have a method by which we can sample these fetal cells without pricking the fetus. So that is your non-invasive prenatal testing. So small fragments of DNA are derived from the apoptosis of placenta, and then these fragments of DNA are isolated from the maternal blood. ओके, सो दिस इज वॉट सेल फ्री फीटल डीएनए. सो वॉट आर वी टेस्टिंग फॉर? वी आर टेस्टिंग फॉर सेल फ्री फीटल डीएनए. Right now, this can be detected better after 10 weeks gestation, and it is cleared from the maternal circulation within 2 days of delivery. So this NIPT has been very, very useful in diagnosing your Down syndrome and other trisomies. Okay, but the accuracy is 98%. If we get a positive result, then we still need to confirm the result by an invasive test. Because suppose you get a positive result for Down syndrome, yes, you know it is 98% to 99% accurate, but what about the 1%? Since if it is a Down syndrome, you're going to do an MTP, you're going to do a definitive irreversible thing, then what do we need to do? We need to confirm it by invasive testing. Okay, so you have different methods. You have whole genome sequencing, you have chromosome sequencing, single nucleotide polymorphism analysis, which are used for your NIPT. Now, got it? So what are the indications for doing a non-invasive prenatal testing? So suppose it is not done for all low risk women, like the way I told you, your first trimester screening, your serum markers, beta HCG, PAPA, your NT, that was done for everybody, all low risk pregnant women as well. Okay, then you have your second trimester screening, that suppose the lady has missed the first trimester, you can do the second trimester screening. All that is done for everybody. But your NIPT is not done for everybody, and one important reason is that we have only standardized it for those who are high risk, and particularly for your trisomies. And second factor is cost. Okay, so it is a costly test, not available everywhere. So when can we use our NIPT? Suppose the maternal age is 35 years or older, and we want to be very, very sure that this fetus is free of any aneuploidies, any chromosomal abnormality. Fetal ultrasound is suggestive of that there is an increased risk of trisomy. So next I will be talking about what are the ultrasound features which are suggestive of trisomies. So if these are any of those features are present, then we are going to think about NIPT. Suppose the lady got a positive screening result and she wants to avoid your invasive test, right? So we can refer her to NIPT and be explaining her that the accuracy is somewhere around 98 to 99. Suppose the parents have a Robertsonian translocation, history of previous pregnancy with trisomy, previous child is affected, or if you want to do a sex chromosome testing for particular disorders like your X-linked disorders such as your Duchenne muscular dystrophy, your hemophilias, for those cases we want to diagnose, right? Because we know these are X-linked disorders and they are more likely to affect the male child. Okay, and we do not want to unnecessarily sample or unnecessarily do an invasive testing for a female child, right? So your, whether it is your Duchenne muscular dystrophy or your hemophilia A, we can avoid an invasive testing in the female child by doing a sex chromosome testing with NIPT. Okay, now next comes genetic sonogram. So what is a genetic sonogram? It is basically your level 2 right? We are going to assess for any structural abnormalities, and we are also going to look for something called as soft markers, which are suggestive of aneuploidies. What is a soft marker? So there are certain gross malformations which will tell you, okay, now this looks like Down syndrome, this looks like trisomy 18. But there are certain soft markers which these are basically findings which individually they are not very significant, but they have an increased prevalence in the aneuploid population. So suppose I find one soft marker, I'm not that worried, because if I find, but I find two soft markers or three soft markers, then I'm thinking, okay, maybe something is wrong, maybe there is not a gross congenital malformation, but maybe still there is an aneuploidy. Okay, so this is the role of a genetic sonogram. Now, so in a genetic sonogram, we will look for major anomalies such as you have your congenital heart defects, right? Particularly your hypoplastic left heart or your endocardial cushion defect. Okay, duodenal atresia. Now, this is very, very indicative of Down syndrome. Holoprosencephaly, very, very indicative of trisomy 18. Omphalocele. So these four findings are very, very characteristically pointing towards some aneuploidy. Okay, so we want to look for this: congenital heart defects, duodenal atresia, holoprosencephaly, and omphalocele. Okay, got it? Now this table is from Williams. I have just kept it to show you that there are a lot of soft markers, and they can ask you which of these is a soft marker, which of these is not a soft marker. So what is a soft marker? I told you, individually they are not suggestive of aneuploidy, but they are associated with an increased prevalence of aneuploidy. So if you have one, two or more, then you are more worried about it. Right, so there are certain ones which we need to remember. Particularly, you have your echogenic bowel. Echogenic bowel means that the bowel is very, very shiny. All the ultrasound, it is shining as much as the bone. Okay, then second is your nasal bone hypoplasia or absence. Then third is nuchal fold thickening. Okay, nuchal fold thickening. So till 11, I told you we will be measuring the nuchal translucency. After 14 weeks, we will call it as the nuchal fold thickening. Then you have your renal pelvis dilatation, or also called as pilectasis. Okay, then there can be a gap between the first and the second toe, that is called as sandal gap. Okay, then you have your clinodactyly, that is hypoplasia of the fifth digit middle phalanx. So if now when you are reading this, and you must have read in pediatrics also, that these are all features, your clinodactyly and sandal gap are features of Down syndrome, right? So that is why these are soft markers which are associated with Down syndrome on your ultrasound. So you must remember, or you must have an idea of these. Okay, then you could have that the long bones are short. So what is happening? Your femur is short, your humerus is short. Another thing is single umbilical artery. So you all know that the umbilical cord contains one umbilical vein and two umbilical arteries. The presence of a single umbilical artery will be indicative of your trisomies, okay, and also seen in diabetes mellitus. Right, single transverse palmar crease, indicative of Down syndrome, flat facies. So all these are soft signs which are associated with fetal trisomy. Okay, now I told you about nuchal fold thickness. So thickness of the skin of the posterior neck, and the cutoff is taken as 6 millimeter. Again, increased risk of chromosomal anomalies, trisomy 21, Turner syndrome. Also, this increased NFT can be indicative of single gene conditions and congenital heart disease. Okay, now, so again, this table I have kept from Williams just to explain you certain things, that there are certain soft markers which are very, very indicative of aneuploidies. There are certain soft markers which have a value, but that strength is not that much. So nuchal skin fold thickening is one very, very important soft marker. Okay, major malformations, I already told you, whether it is your duodenal atresia, it is your congenital heart defect, it is your holoprosencephaly, omphalocele. These are major anomalies. They are associated with aneuploidies. In the soft markers, very important is your nuchal skin fold thickening, echogenic bowel, short bones or short humerus. So these three at least we need to remember. Okay, increased nuchal skin fold thickening, echogenic bowel and short humerus. I'm going over these things again and again because they are a little difficult to remember, particularly because you have not seen these things, right? So other than that, you have other markers like your renal pelvis dilatation, echogenic intracardiac focus. Okay, and I told you that if you have two or more markers or three or more markers, then the risk of aneuploidy is going to go up. Don't need to remember these numbers, but need to understand what is the importance of these factors. Okay, now I told you that there are certain gross congenital malformations which can be diagnosed at 11 to 14 weeks. Typically, your neural tube, open neural tube defects, acrania, anencephaly, A-lobar, holoprosencephaly, omphalocele, very lethal skeletal defects, and your AVSD and hypoplastic left heart. So these are all the major anomalies which are pointing towards aneuploidies, and they can be detected early in 11 to 14 weeks. If you detect it early, you can sample, do an invasive testing early, you can do a chorionic villus sampling, the couple will have a diagnosis earlier and can make a decision accordingly. Right? Now, what about multiple pregnancy? So yes, there are two fetuses, the risk of aneuploidy goes up, because if you remember, I told you one is the dizygotic fetus where there are two separate zygotes. Okay, then one is the monozygotic fetus which is going to divide. Now during this division, again chromosomal problems can arise. So what do you do for twins? So whenever you have to, if they ask you what is the best test, then nuchal translucency of each twin plus the maternal age is the ideal method for twin pregnancy. Okay, got it? So NT as well as maternal age. Okay, now what about if suppose if you have a monochorionic twin or if you have a dichorionic twin, then in a dichorionic two separate placenta we will calculate the NT for each and we will compare it like two individuals separately. In monochorionic we will take the NT and we are going to take out an average or a single risk estimate, right? In a twin pregnancy I told you NT and maternal age is the best choice. Combined screening, that is your first trimester serum markers, that is your beta HCG and Pap A, can be done, but okay, we do not have such very good can be done if required, right? But your second trimester screening, your triple screening, quadruple screening is not done for multiple pregnancy because there are going to be a lot, the accuracy is not good. So that is why second trimester screening is not done for twin pregnancy, okay? Now, so summary, screen all women irrespective of age, and genetic counseling and testing for aneuploidy and follow-up ultrasound for all those who are coming with a increased nuchal translucency or who have an obvious anomaly or a cystic hygroma identified. Cell-free fetal DNA is a screening test and cannot be used as a substitute for diagnostic test. Okay, whenever it comes positive, you need to do a diagnostic confirmatory test. Okay. Now, so let us look at the accuracy and the detection rate. So in the first trimester screening, when you are doing your nuchal translucency plus the serum markers, that is your combined testing, the accuracy is somewhere around 80 to 84. When you are doing only NT, then look at the accuracy, it has dropped down, right? Now, quadruple test, only quadruple test, then the accuracy is 80 to 82. But there is something called as integrated testing. Integrated testing is what? Combined testing in the first trimester followed by quadruple test. Okay, so look at this. The accuracy has increased to 94 to 96%, and the most accurate of all is among your screening tests is cell-free fetal DNA, which has an accuracy of 98%. Okay, but remember, none of these are confirmatory. If they come positive, we need to do a confirmatory test, that is in the form of invasive test, whether CBS or amnio or cordocentesis. Got it? So combined testing, that is first trimester testing, NT, HCG, PAPA. Okay, then you have your second trimester, that is in the form of quadruple test. Okay, or in our country, still many places we are doing still triple screen only. Then you have your integrated testing, that is combined test plus the quadruple screen. Okay, that has a very high accuracy, around 94 to 96%, and cell-free fetal DNA, which has an accuracy of 98%. Right. So now just let us solve a few questions to get an idea what are the kind of questions that have been asked in the recent few years. What is a non-invasive prenatal testing? It is A option is preconceptional gene testing on the ova. B is testing on maternal tissue. C is maternal serum for evaluation of Down syndrome. And D is amniocentesis for evaluation of fetal chromosomal anomalies. So D is absolutely incorrect, right? This is definitely invasive, amniocentesis. We have done. Preconceptional gene testing on ova is an entirely different thing. It is pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. Okay, here what do we do in pre-implantation genetic diagnosis? Once your either the gamete is sampled or your zygote has formed, after that we take a biopsy from the zygote, okay, and then we will look for that particular single gene disorder or chromosomal anomaly. That is a pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, okay? That's not different, that is not the same as NIPT. So testing on maternal tissue, again no. NIPT is what? Maternal serum evaluation for Down syndrome, okay? So C is the answer here. Now let us look at the next question. A 37-year-old Gravida 2 Para 1 Live 1 woman at 14 weeks attends the antenatal clinic. She had a normal dating scan, and on the first trimester screening, her Pap A was low and the free beta HCG was high. Okay, so Pap A is low, the beta HCG is high. I told you, remember, what is the aneuploidy? Trisomy 21. Okay, trisomy 21, that is A option. ओके इन ट्राइसोमी 18 एंड 13 एंड टर्नर बोथ आर डिक्रीज, योर बीटा एचसीजी एंड पैपे बोथ आर डिक्रीज राइट. न्यूकल ट्रांसलूसेंसी इन अल्ट्रासाउंड कैन बी डिटेक्टेड एट हाउ मेनी वीक्स ऑफ जेस्टेशन. ओके सो आई टोल्ड यू 11 टू 13 और 11 टू 14 वट एवर दे हैव गिवन एन ऑप्शन. सो दे हैव गिवन यू द ऑप्शन 11 टू 13. देर इज ऑल्सो अ क्राइटेरिया फॉर योर सी आर एल दैट इज योर 36 टू 84 मिलीमीटर. Right now, so again, this figure we should remember, this is the hypoechoic zone. Okay, this is your nuchal translucency, this is the nasal bone. Now, which of the following is not done in quadruple test for antenatal detection of Down syndrome? A is alpha fetoprotein, B is beta HCG, C is estradiol, and D is inhibin. Okay, so I told you that's why very important to remember the full forms. Okay, alpha fetoprotein definitely done, beta HCG definitely done, inhibin yes it is done. Which one? Inhibin A is done. Estradiol no. What do we do? We do unconjugated estriol. Okay, so which is not done in quadruple test? C. Got it? Now, so with this I am going to close my session for you today. Okay, this was the part on antenatal screening. I'll have one more session with you where we will talk about your invasive testing, your amniocentesis, your CBS and your CORDO. That's going to be a relatively shorter session and we will do a few more MCQs at the end. So if you like the session, please like us, subscribe us on YouTube, follow us on YouTube, Telegram, hit the bell icon. Use my code Dr. Deepika to subscribe for the plus and the iconic subscription. Okay. If you have any doubts, I'd be very happy to clear.